Hi there, friends. You know, I'm so glad that Jesus offers so much more than just boring routine, perfect doctrine, another theory, but that he has come to give us abundant, adventurous, even dangerous life, real life. You know, when John starts writing in 1 John 1, excuse me, this was about probably 90 years after the ascension. And the last time he wrote in the Gospel of John, one of the last few things he said is that there were many, many more things that Jesus both did and said that if he had to write it down, all the books in the world would not be able to contain. So you can imagine people throughout the many years after he wrote the Gospel and when he writes this letter, how many people asked him, "Oh, John, just write down a few more of those parables. You know, those stories which you said Jesus did many more things, but you never captured in your Gospel. Why don't you write another book? Now, maybe there's just one parable that we're missing that's the key to our breakthrough. Or one more story that will ignite faith." So yeah, about 90 years after the ascension, John starts writing again. And what is so amazing is that he's not occupied at all with a memory of a historic Jesus. Let me start reading to you in verse 1. "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, and which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life. The life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and manifested to us or in us. That which we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. These things we write to you, that your joy may be full." You see, what occupied John was not the memory of a historic Christ, but the reality of a present Christ. And the whole purpose of his communication, the whole purpose of our communication, why do we chat and why do we meet together? Why do we have fellowship? It's not to just inform one another. It's to awaken, stir up life. God has come and made his home in us. And that fellowship, that intimacy is what motivates us to communicate with one another and to stir up that same life in one another. So he says the whole reason we write this is so that your joy may be full. You know, so often we can get so stuck just in a memory of what God did. No, and it's beautiful to have testimonies. It's beautiful to have stories of what God's done in your life. And it's a good thing to remember them. But if there's not a present awareness of the indwelling Christ, even those stories of God's goodness in the past become stale. They become old. Now, I'm so glad that when John starts writing this gospel, he doesn't try and just revisit again the same old stories, the same old parables, the same things. I mean, these aren't just any parables or any stories. He walked with Jesus for 3 years, maybe a bit longer. But what he learned is that what Christ came to introduce us to is not just a memory of a historic Christ, but the intimacy with the Father, the intimacy that he had in mind from the very beginning, the fellowship, the life that gave birth to the idea of man, has now come and made his abode within us. So this is the object of John's writing. I mean, even Peter, I think it's 2 Peter 3, he says that the whole reason we write this is to stir up your sincere minds by way of reminder. There's a stirring up that's the purpose of all our communication. And not the stirring up of just a certain way of thinking, but the stirring up of life. Let me explain it this way. There's two kinds of knowledge. There's a knowledge that's birthed out of relationship, and there's a knowledge that's purely academic. When I fell in love with Mary Ann many years ago, there were many things that I did not know about her. I didn't know many things about her past. I didn't even know what her middle name was. I didn't know her date of birth when I first saw her. But I knew enough to know that I'm madly in love. And even after our relationship started developing, I was so captured, intrigued by just her person, that all the other bits of information was irrelevant. I still don't think I know what subject she studied at school. I know a few or so, but you know, there's something so much more relevant to our relationship than dry information. And God wants to bring us to a place where we understand that our fellowship together with one another is much more, and with him, is much more than just academic exercise. It is a fellowship that will impart understanding to you, but it's a intimate knowledge. It's a relational knowledge. And that intimacy will birth in you depths of understanding which you could never gain from pure study. It's called revelation knowledge. It's a knowledge that's birthed out of intimacy. And let me quickly take you to an example in Hebrews 10 from verse 19. He says here, therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the Holy of Holies by the blood of Jesus. So he just spoke in the previous few verses about the fact that God has completely and utterly dealt with every obstacle that stood between himself and man. But he has removed sin so successfully that he no longer remembers it. And therefore on that basis he says, you can have such boldness to come, to encounter him by a new and living way which he prepared for us through the veil, that is his flesh. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near. I mean, everything in this opportunity has been prepared. Right now, where you are, God's ready to encounter with you. From his point of view, there's nothing that's standing between you. He's just saying, come, draw near with boldness. In full assurance of faith, having your heart sprinkled from an evil conscience and your bodies washed with pure water, let us hold fast the confession of our faith without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together. No wonder I was reading that, and I suddenly realized that in the same breath in which he invites us to encounter God, He invites us to encounter one another. Now, it's God's purpose for us to encounter Him in one another. It is part of the way in which you know God is in the fellowship you have with those who are made in His image and in His likeness. God manifests Himself, makes Himself known. The way in which He makes Himself known, the way in which He chose to be Himself is in and through man. And that's why in the same breath in which He invites us to encounter Him intimately, He's saying, don't neglect meeting together with one another. I want to give you a new vision of what your fellowship with one another is about. It's an opportunity to encounter God, nothing less.